Want an easier way to shop for your kids? At Stitch Fix, we make finding kids' clothes easy.
Break every chain. You gotta know within yourself that there's power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And this army is an obedient army. Hallelujah. This army is a righteous, holy army. Amen. There's an army rising. I hope you know it. Every chain. Okay. I hear you, sis. I love you. God bless you. There's power in the name of Jesus. But it's also deliverance. Hallelujah. Sanctifying power. I felt God right there. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. There's power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. To break every chain. Break every chain. I'm sorry, y'all. We finna get into Bible study, but I just needed to hear this for my soul's sake. Hallelujah. Reminding myself that there's power in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hey. Hallelujah. Listen. Yes, God. Hallelujah. All right, we're finna get into the word. Now I needed to hear this. My God, can you hear it in the spirit? I don't care what you're facing, but you gotta be able to hear in the spirit that those chains of addiction, oppression, and depression, those chains are falling by the name, the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hey, financial bondage of chains is falling now in the name of Jesus. Chains of inadequacy is falling in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. All right, preacher, I hear you. I'm looking forward to you. Love you so much. Listen, we hear the chains falling. We know that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than we could ask or think, according to the power that's working on the inside of us. We give God praise and glory and honor tonight because of who he is. And we submit to the righteous sovereign power of Jesus Christ that he would cause us to walk in humility, in humbleness, that he would cause us to walk in sanctification, in holiness. Hallelujah. That there is a holy way to walk and there is a righteous way to walk. And the Holy Spirit himself is leading us and he's guiding us into all truths of the word of God. Listen, whatever you hide, you can't heal from. But what you will have the courage in God to say, it's me, Lord, standing in the need of prayer. I'm telling you tonight that chains can fall. And not can, the chains will fall under the matchless and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Listen, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ on tonight. Listen, we're excited about the word. There's power in the person of Jesus Christ. There's power in the word of God. Can't nobody do you like Jesus can do you. And I know it might be a cliche, it might be something the saints say, but I found it to be a truth. Hallelujah, be a truth that can't nobody do you like Jesus can. You know what we found out in walking with Jesus a long time, and some of us a short time, but what you'll find out to know is that the very thing you knew that you could lean on forever and you could depend on forever, the very people you thought you can lean on forever and would be there forever, you found out that they did not have the ability to be there forever. But God, hallelujah, is an unchanging God. He's always right there, hallelujah, waiting on us to call on his great name. And so I admonish you, no matter what your situation may be, no matter what your kids' situation may be, no matter what your grandbaby's situation may be, no matter what your situation, no matter if it's your job, I don't care what it is, God has the power to free, deliver, and set free tonight. There are chains that can be broken tonight. All you have to do is call on him, and all you have to do is believe. The book of Mark tells us, if you say unto a mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, and doubt not in your heart, but believe whatsoever you say it, you'll have it. All you've got to do is believe. He's got the power to do. Amen. So tonight we are in the book of Hebrews, chapter 7. Amen. And I want all of you to be filled with the Holy Ghost. I want all of you to be filled with the joy of the Lord. I want all of you to have a smile, hallelujah, that lets the devil know that I might be going through, but the operative, hallelujah, is that word through. I'm going, but I'm going through. I'm not stuck in transition. I'm on my way somewhere in God. Hallelujah. It may not look like I want it to look, but God has a plan. I wish I had a church. God's got a plan and God's got a purpose. And I need you to be able to say it with confidence. We're not bragging, but we got confidence in our God. God's got a plan for my life. And I know it might look a little bleak. It might look a little bad right now, but God is, hallelujah, is going to bring us on through, and he's going to bring us through on time. Hallelujah. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. But I need you to know tonight, God will deliver us from them all. Hallelujah. He said, in this world, I don't know, somebody needs encouragement tonight. Thank you, Holy Ghost. In this world, you're going to have much trouble. He said, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. I need you to know tonight, hallelujah, that God has put a word in your mouth. Yes, he has. And that word is victory. Hallelujah. Victory shall be mine. I remember being a little girl and we would sing, victory is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Mm-mm-mm. I told Satan, hey, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Victory. I don't know who needs to hear that. I don't know who needs to be reminded, but it must be that God really needed you to hear for me to have to sing it. Praise his holy and high name. But victory is yours. Victory is yours. Get that in your spirit tonight. Victory is yours. I don't care what you are facing. Victory is yours in your body. Victory is yours in your mind. Victory is yours in your relationships. Victory is yours in your ministry, in your money. I mean, in the madness, victory is yours. Grab hold to that word. Hallelujah. Grab hold to it. Listen, we're in the book of Hebrews. Amen. Chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7. I'm being blessed by the word of God. We're literally taking our time going through the book of Hebrews. There's something in it for each and every one of us. Now, you know, on the onset, let me say this. Let's get into the teaching. God, we thank you for your word tonight. Open up the mystery of your will. Father God, we're nothing and you're everything. We ask, oh God, that by the precious Holy Spirit, you would cause the word to be unveiled, that we may receive it with joy in the name of Jesus. Forgive us of our sins and shortcomings. Forgive us, oh Lord, for any moment in our life when we try to do it our way and not acknowledge you as being sovereign and Lord. You are the supreme God. We honor you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm not sure. On my end, it looks like I'm getting some glitches. I mean, some jumping. Somebody talk to me. How does it look on your end tonight? Are we having some technical difficulties? I can switch it if I need to. I can switch the phones. I can... if I have to, start over, we can log off. How does it look on your end? Is everything coming in clear? Can you hear me? Are you able to see me well? Talk back to me, somebody. Thumbs up or something. Let me know. Am I coming through good? Or are we having some? All right. Praise God. All right. Thank you so much, sister. Appreciate that, Sister Hendon. All right. So we are chapter seven of the book of Hebrews. And, you know, last week we ended chapter 6. We've been going full steam ahead. All right, praise God. Thank you, little sis. D, we appreciate that. We've been going full steam ahead in the book of Hebrews. Now, I do want to say this to us tonight. The book of Hebrews, again, was written to the Jewish community from what we understand. All right. So as far as theologians have come together and have given their spiritual synopsis, they believe that this book was written to the Jewish people. Now, I also want to remind us that as we study the book of Hebrews, it also starts out with us already knowing history. So the book of Hebrews does not take its time to say, you know, this is how it all started. You know, Moses and then Abraham and then Abraham's kids, his boys and et cetera, et cetera. So it jumps right in. So the book of Hebrews comes real hard and real fast because it doesn't give us any background, if you will, from some of the things that it's presented. So it presents to us, and it started presenting very strongly in the book, the fifth chapter of Hebrews. The sixth chapter, talking about Melchizedek. And it's important because Melchizedek and Abraham, there's a direct connection. So in the seventh chapter is going to bring out some more of that so that we'll see. All right. So we understand that Abraham is the father of the nation of Israel, right? All right. So the Israelites. So Abraham had Isaac, right? Then Isaac has Jacob. And then through Jacob, we get the 12 tribes of Israel, which are the 12 sons of Jacob. All right. God makes a promise to Abraham, and then he starts to literally work out by Jacob the promise that he has made to Abraham. All right? Now, because of, and I'm trying to set this up before we get into chapter 7. Because of what the priest Melchizedek does, that is why the writer of Hebrews is then making some direct, you know, assessment of what must be as it pertains to the priesthood. So let me say it again. Abraham is the father, right, of Isaac and Jacob. Jacob, who becomes Israel in name, also births, right, the children of Israel. So the 12 tribes are the 12 sons of Jacob. Now, out of the 12 sons, which also represent the 12 tribes, one of the tribe is the name Levi. The Levites are the priest. In order to be a priest, you must be born out of the tribe of Levi. All right? And again, the book of Hebrew is presenting this to us as if we already know all of these things. Most of us do. But just in case somebody's popping on our lives tonight and they don't have that background, we want to take it slow so that you'll have content. Why? Because when we start reading this, if you don't understand who Abraham is and who Levi is, then it can be confusing. So again, Abraham has Isaac. Isaac birthed Jacob, right? Jacob has 12 sons. Those 12 sons become the head of each tribe, right? That encompasses or makes up Israel. Each tribe is over, has one son over it. The son Levi is the tribe that all priests must come from. So all priests are blessed through the lineage of Levi. So in order to be a priest, you must come out of what tribe? Levi. All right? So let's make sure that makes sense. Now, once you are a priest, you are out of the Levitical order, which simply means, Levitical order means you have been born out of the tribe of Levi, which is a descendant of Abraham. So what the seventh chapter of Hebrews is about to present to us is presenting it to us with all of that information in mind. So in order to serve as a priest, you give your life as a Levite. Just like we do, some of us who preach the gospel, you know, we may have a small job, a little job, or no job, and most of our whole day is really given to preaching and teaching and praying and doing the will of, and work of God. And so it is then the love that the people have for the man or woman of God that they bless them financially to keep doing the work of God. That is biblical. That is the way God set it up for the Levite. Why? Because it was their job to make sure they ministered in the sanctuary, ministered and did the work of service. So the tithe, watch this, the tithe, the money that was given to the church was taken and given to the Levite. Why? Because their life was dedicated to the service and work of the church, the sanctuary or synagogue in that time. It is a principle. Why is it a principle? You're going to see it. It's going to make more sense when you have the background as to what's happening in the seventh chapter of Hebrew without understanding order that God set. Because God is saying, out of this tribe of Levi, it's going to be the Levitical order. They will sing. They will play instruments. They will be the keyboard player. They will be the drummer. They will be, everything that happens in that synagogue happens through Levitical order. So what happens then is God is saying to the Levite, don't worry about what you're going to eat, drink, clothes. The people will be a blessing to you. So you can spend most of your day worrying about what you're going to say, what you're going to sing, how you're going to praise and worship and all of those things. So the Levite were commissioned by God to do the work. And then the people of God would give money. They would give their tent. They would give their animals, whatever. They would give to the church, the synagogue. And then God commanded that they then would give that to the Levite so that they would go forth with not having to worry about work and things of that nature, because this is what God called them to do. It is a principle in Scripture. Now, you don't take the principle and then put a burden on the people. It is for God to say who will and who won't. It is for God to say what he will allow and what he won't allow. That's not for us to determine. Bless his high name. That's not for us to determine. So what God told me, hey, I want you to quit this job. I want you to give yourself to ministry. I trust God. I'm not going to browbeat and make people feel bad and be like, you got to do this and you got to do that. No, you give. When the Holy Ghost say give, you give. And when he don't, you don't. And you don't browbeat and you don't force it on people. You let the love of God be shared abroad. And through the love of God, people give. And we will see this. Listen, just trust me that I'm helping us. If you don't have this background, so that when we read chapter 7, it will make sense to you. All right? Let's go into the word. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 1. Now, this Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. So it starts out in chapter seven, saying that this person who is a priest is literally a priest of God himself. Do you see that in Scripture? Watch what he says. He met Abraham returning from defeat of the kings and blessed him. Number one, I'm not looking for the people to bless me if I can't bless the people. Now, I said a thing. I can't look for the people, even as a priest. I got to be first willing to be a blessing. Hallelujah to you in some form, whether it's financially or whether it's me speaking a word, whether the Holy Ghost is using me to unlock some bondage, whatever it is, I need to first be a blessing to you, because the Bible declares that like people, like priests, you learn how to be a blessing. You learn how to love. You ought to be able to watch your leader's life and learn how to love above offense. Learn how to give even when you don't have much. You watch your priests, like people, like leaders. So we go before you to show you. The Bible says that the first thing that Melchizedek does is he blesses Abraham. Now watch this. Verse 2. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. You ought to have a response, people of God, that when you are blessed by the man or woman of God, you need to be a blessing. Now, I'm telling you the truth because it's the truth of God. It's not a, what do they call it? I can't think of it right now. A prosperity message. Right? Where we're saying, give. I need this and I need that. I need a Mercedes and I need, the devil is a liar. You ought to be commissioned by the Holy Ghost and be able to give as God leads you to give, not because you feel bad or guilty. If you feel bad or you feel guilty and somebody is shaming you to give, I don't care if it's a song. You should not feel guilty into singing a solo. You should not feel guilty as in coming to church during a pandemic. I said it. And I mean it. You should not be bullied by someone to make you give of your time or your money, your body or your strength. You should do it because you love God and the word of God finds you and you feel compelled by the Holy Ghost to do what you do. Why? Because if you do it for any other reason than for God, everything that we do that we don't do for God will not last. It won't matter. It means nothing. We must offer it up in faith to God. Amen? Bless his name. So Abraham responds to the blessing of the priest by giving him a tenth. The Bible says a tenth of everything. First, his name means King of Righteousness. Then also King of Salem means King of Peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life. Like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Why is that important? It is important because Hebrews is setting us up with an understanding. Watch me, because I don't want to lose you. Listen, please listen to what I'm about to tell you. Remember what I said. The way it's set up in each tribe of Israel, each tribe, the only tribe where priests came from was out of the Levitical order, or Levi, out of the bloodline of Levi. Here we see another priest who has no mother, who has no father. In other words, there's no genealogy to trace him back. He has no beginning. He has no end. You see this? So when Jesus comes, he is not subject to the Levitical order, because he is going to come out of the order of Melchizedek. Let's read it again. It says, first, his name means King of Righteousness. Then also King of Salem, meaning King of Peace. Without father or mother, meaning he has no beginning, he has no ending, we don't know where he comes from. Then it says, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life. Like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. So in order for God, watch me, listen closely, watch what I'm saying, hear what I'm saying. In order for there to be a new way that is more powerful than the old way, God had to bring a priest that would not fall up under the old way. He had to bring Christ through a priestly genealogy that has no mother and that has no father, that has no beginning and has no end. Because the new priest, the priestly order that Christ is coming into, it's because, watch this, he cannot be subject to what the natural priest was subject to, because what we needed this priest to do was something the other priests, all other priests could not do. All right? So listen to what he says, verse 4. Listen to verse 4. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of his plunder. Now the law requires descendants. You see it? You see it in scripture. You see it, Devitria? You see that? Devitria, you see that? Look at verse 5. Now the law requires the descendants of Levi, who became priests, to collect a tenth from the people. That is, their brothers, even though they were brothers, are descendants of Abraham. This man, however, did not trace his descendant from Levi. You see that? Yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. And without doubt, the lesser person is blessed by the greater. I'm about to get happy. Woo, God. Okay, what he's saying is that in the spiritual realm, in order for there to be a shifting, there has to be a giving. If you notice, in all of what God does, he starts with a seed. The more you give, the more you get, because you shift something in the spiritual realm when you release unto God by faith. What Abraham did in the under the order of Melchizedek was that he shifted something in his whole bloodline, and it started with the seed of a tithe, an offering. Don't you ever let the devil convince you that when you plant seed that there won't be a benefit in the kingdom. I'm not telling God, listen, I'm planting the seed, and if you don't do it, oh God, I'm just gonna die. God, if you don't do it, you ain't real. No, I release it in faith because I believe that when I bless someone else, it's the greatest thing I can do. Not bless them so I can get, but the greatest thing I can do is to bless someone, period. And Abraham submits to the order that he knew. Abraham is going to be the great, it's going to be the grandfather of Levi. And the priests are going to come out of him. Literally, Abraham has set the precedent. He's saying, I'm not going to ask you to do something I won't do myself. You see this? If you're going to be a leader and you're going to lead well, the very most wonderful, beautiful thing we do as leaders is we give. We give not only of our money, but we give of our time. We give of our strength. We give of our wisdom. We give. That is one of the greatest privileges we have as leaders, is to be able to teach other people how to give. I wish I had a church right here. If you're not a giving leader, something is broken in you. If you're not giving your love, if you're not giving joy, if you're not giving peace to somebody, you're not giving understanding, if you're not giving kindness, something is broken in you. You've got to get to the altar so that God can deliver you, so that you can be the leader God has called you truly to be. Abraham is setting his whole bloodline up because he is operating in the right way towards the priest, Melchizedek. Now watch what he says. Verse 8. In one case, the tenth is collected by men who die, but in the other case, by him who is declared to be living. One might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth through Abraham, because when Melchizedek met Abraham, Levi was still in the body, oh my God, of his ancestor. Do you hear what the word of God just said? What he's saying, this is so powerful. What the writer is saying, initially, what just happened was Levi, through Abraham, has blessed this priest. Because the order of all priestly, priestly order of Levi has not even been established yet, but yet he's getting credit. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. This is what he's saying. Look at what he said. Let's look at it again. One might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth. You see that? Now, this, I'm telling you, this is powerful. He's saying that through Abraham, Levi paid the tenth. I'm sorry, through Abraham, Levi paid the tenth. Because verse 10, because when Melchizedek met Abraham, Levi was still in the body of his ancestor. I'll tell you, that's beautiful and powerful all at the same time. Oh, I'm telling you, God is a man. Could not one other person come up with something this powerful. This is such a beautiful illustration of predestined purpose. In other words, what was it that could have came through your mother or your grandmother, great grandfather, or your father that came through them on behalf of who you are? Oh my God. This is powerful and such a beautiful illustration of when we talk about being predestined, order of God. Now look, now this in verse 11 it says, if perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, for on the basis of the law, you know, was given to the people, why was there still need for another priest to come? He's asking us a question. One in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron. Because we know Aaron was a priest as well. You see that? Now let's look at it. He of whom these things are said belong to a different tribe. And no one from the tribe had ever served at the altar. For it is clear that our Lord descended from Judah. And in regard to the tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. And what he has said is even more clear if another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest is not on the basis of the regulation as his ancestry, but on the basis of the power, my God, of an indestructible life. For it is declared, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. See, the former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless. So he asked a question. Why was it necessary, if it was such a great way, for another order of priests to come in? If that order worked, why did we need a new one? And it, so then watch the Bible. It then answers the question for us. It says the reason God comes and sets a new priestly order is because the former regulations is set aside because it was weak and useless. For the law made nothing perfect. Look at your Bible. And a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. Now, my God. So what he's saying is, the way that God originally set it up, he set it up under the order of the Levitical order. Meaning that in the beginning, the set order of the priesthood came through a natural means. And in order for us to get the spiritual redemption, we needed someone that could connect us back to God spiritually. The Bible says, what is it? John 3. Hold on. I'm going to read it. Hold your finger right there. I'm going to go get it. Y'all hold on right there. Y'all stay right where you are. And I'm going to go get it. I can quote it, but I want to read it to you. Because I want to make sure that I'm doing it. I want to make sure that I'm saying it right. John 3:6. It says, flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit gives birth to spirit. What is that saying to us? In order for there to be a spiritual reconnection back to God, there had to be an order that was not rooted in natural. The Levitical order was from a natural priesthood, but the Melchizedek order was from a spiritual one, because it tells us, how do we know? He has no beginning, he has no end, he has no genealogy. So he's allowed, God has allowed Christ to connect to a priest that allows us to connect back to God through this priest, because it's now, watch this, turns from now natural, and now it's no more natural through Levi, now it's spiritual through Jesus Christ. You see that? Does that make sense? Let me slow it down a little. In verse 19, chapter 7, it says, for the law made nothing perfect. In other words, through the old way, it was laws and regulations that we could never keep up with. It was a priest that if he sinned, he dropped dead. If he didn't get everything right, he would drop dead. So God establishes through Jesus Christ, under the order of a priesthood that was not natural, for us to have Jesus Christ as our high priest, so that when he entered in, he could enter in on our behalf once and for all. See, that's why it's important that we understand why God set it up. He set it up in the natural as a type, a shadow of who and what was to come. Jesus is going to be a priest, but watch this. He does not come out of the Levitical order, the Levitical priesthood. He comes under Melchizedek, who has no father, no genealogy, he's the priest of God. See that? So that's why we must have an understanding that God set it up in the natural, because this is what it's going to mirror, but he's going to substantiate it through his power spiritually through Christ Jesus. In other words, in the natural, the priest would go in for us with bulls, blood, sacrifices. They would have to do it every year, because there was no power in the animal's blood to sustain the sacrifice of life. Remember, it's a substitute. Our life, the animal's life, was taken for our life, for our sin and disobedience. Christ comes as the priest who would go in once and for all, because he became the lamb whose blood was pure. So he could go into heaven once and for all and offer the sacrifice that the Levitical order could not do, because they were weakened because of the sinful nature of man. So Christ comes and does not sin in his body, so that he could become not only priest, but also our sacrifice. A natural order priest could not do that. The Levitical order, no Levi could be a priest without sin and be the lamb of the sacrifice. See, only Christ could do these things. So that's what the book of Hebrew is pointing out, is that he and I think this is another thing that I really want us to understand. Even the genealogy of Jesus Christ as it pertains to his natural parent, even when you look at the bloodline in the natural sense, he comes out of the tribe of Judah. And that's a whole another topic. But Judah means praise. My God. That's a whole another topic. We can spend a whole another 45 minutes on the idea that Jesus comes out of Judah. Judah means to plow, to praise. Hallelujah. But I'm going to refrain myself and go right back to what we're talking about tonight. But oh, I double dog dare you to get a praise in your mouth and watch and see what praise will bring forth. Okay. All right. Now, here we go. Let me get back to it. Now, verse 19. For the law made nothing perfect, and a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. In other words, because of this new hope and what Christ is doing for us, we're able now to draw near to God. Because of the old Levitical order, we could not be drawn closer to God, because even though they made sacrifices, sin was still a part of our life. But what Jesus does is he separates us from the penalty of sin, which causes us to have peace with God. Y'all see that? Because he does an eternal sacrifice with his body and his blood, and he becomes forever the eternal sacrifice for us all. And it calls peace to be with God. We'll see that later on in Hebrews. Now watch this. Verse 20. And it was not without an oath. All right. God is always on oath. Like, I'm going to make an oath with you. Like, I'm going to do it. He says, others became priests without any oath. But he became a priest with an oath when God said to him, The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. My God. Verse 22. Because of this oath, Jesus has become a guarantee of a better, watch the word, covenant. Okay? Jesus has become a better covenant. Say it again in your hearing. Jesus has become a better covenant. Jesus is the new covenant. My God. Jesus himself became the new covenant. He guarantees the covenant. He is the covenant. He powers the covenant. He substantiates the covenant. He upholds the covenant. He did all the religious requirements of the covenant. All together, it's Jesus. Watch verse 23. Now, there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. See that? Therefore, he is able to serve completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede, oh my God, for them. Yes, a better covenant. Yes, sister. All right, listen. I want you to pick up something else very powerful in the 7th chapter of Hebrews. God, because he's God, a permanent, that's right, amen, permanent. Because he is God, listen to me. What time is it? All right, because he is God, if he wanted to, he could have just brought Jesus in, made him priest, and moved on, and we would have got the same results. But God is a principle-setting God, and he is an order-keeping God. And he made sure that even Jesus Christ falls subject to leadership, that he didn't just pop up as a priest. But he had to fall subject to the order of Melchizedek, that because God is a God of order. And I don't know how many times I got to remind us, God is a God of order, and he falls subject to order. Let me help you tonight. This is what the Holy Ghost showed. Thank you. This is what the Holy Ghost showed me last week or 2 weeks ago. I was reading about John the Baptist, and I got a word. Mm-hmm. We might share it next week on Morning Manna. But the Spirit of God said, and those of you who study with me before, you've already heard this. And you might just already know this because you're wonderful. But John the Baptist was the close of the Old Covenant. Mm-hmm. So the Old Testament closes at the life and the death of John the Baptist. I said, that's powerful, God. I feel the Holy Ghost. Y'all don't know. I want to jump up and run. I feel him so heavy. I said, okay, God. And he said, listen. I started reading about John the Baptist. I mean, he's so heavy on me. I want to bust out in tears right now. And I started reading about John the Baptist. And I was like, man, it's jacked up the way John the Baptist dies. Right? If you haven't read the story, if you're not familiar, you know, get your refreshing, go read how John the Baptist dies, because I just don't have time tonight. But long story short, his head, I'm telling you, I feel God, his head is brought in on a platter. They literally chop off the head of John the Baptist and brings him in. I said, man, it's a, y'all don't understand how much I feel, y'all, hold on, y'all. Jesus. Whew. Hold on. Whew. God, this revelation is really touching my spirit. I said, God, that was a horrible way for John the Baptist to die, that his head be brought in. This is what God said. God said, I'm a God of order. I won't have two heads. In order for there to be an end of the old covenant and of the Old Testament, I had to de-head, decapitate. I had to cut off the head of the old so that I could establish the new, because Jesus is the head of the church, the head of the new covenant, the head of the New Testament. Oh my God. And so what God is saying is that I'm a God of order. There's no need for two heads. Hallelujah. There's no, I'm telling you, oh my God. He said the head of John the Baptist was symbolic of the cutting off of what was, so that the head of the church, hallelujah, the new covenant, could be established. I can't right now. My God. Woo! And so the Bible is saying, let's get back to Hebrews before I bust out in tears. Y'all just don't know how God revealing that to me changed everything for me. Listen, he says, he is literally creating for us a new way, a new covenant. He is establishing it literally by removing. He says, I set aside the first to establish the second. You see that? Let's go to verse 26. It says, such a high priest meets our need. One who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifice day after day. Watch what he says. First, for his own sins, and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. My God. For the law appoints as high priests men who are weak, but the oath, hallelujah, which came after the law, appointed the Son, capital S, hallelujah, who has been made perfect forever. My God. So now, he's saying, what he's saying is that under the Levitical order, they died. They had to make sacrifices. It was weakened. Hallelujah. Even though they were doing as God had commanded, it never was intended in the natural, hallelujah, to be able to sustain us in the spiritual. Like we said, that which is flesh is flesh. That which is spirit. There had to be something greater than us, something more honorable, something more worthy than us to stand on our behalf. That's why God said, hallelujah, I will come. His son, Jesus says, listen, prepare me a body. I'll go down and redeem them. God, hallelujah. Father, I love them. I will die as them. I will die for them. I will become a priest for them. I will become the offering for them. I will do it. Let me do it. And it's love. It's love. It's love. It's his love for us that he would come. It's his love for us that he would substantiate truth. It's his love for us that he would sacrifice his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. For he did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It is what Jesus has done. And God did it for everyone. The Bible says, for God so loved the world. I don't know why the church forgets it. I don't know why with our religious self, we want to forget that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believeth, but with the mouth confessions are made. It's the word that draws, but it's the power of God through his son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. That keeps us. It's a new order, a new priestly order. It's a new covenant that he has made with us. And he did it through his son, who under the order of Melchizedek is now a priest forever. Let's look at our questions. We got 5 minutes. Tonight was, I'm telling you, I tried to go, Minister Norton, I tried to go slow. Minister Ewing, I tried to go slow tonight. I tried to keep myself calm as best as I could. Talk slow because I really wanted us to get this. How did I do? I pray that we got it. I pray that you got it. If you have questions, put them on the screen. Inbox me. All right. Chapter 7. All right. Let's look at some questions here and we're going to close. You know how we're doing it this week. All right. First question. What are the main points in this chapter? What are the main points in chapter 7? Hebrews chapter 7. What are the main points? So there's 3 main points I want us to remember. The greatness of Melchizedek. The need for a new priesthood. And third, the greatness of Jesus' priesthood. Those 3, all right? The greatness of Melchizedek. The need for a new priesthood, and the greatness of Jesus' priesthood, all right? So those are the 3 main points. There are other ones that we can pull out, but those are 3 that I wanted to bring out tonight. All right, question number 2. Where in the Old Testament can we read about Melchizedek? What? So I'm going to give those to you because it would take a little time to dig that information up. So I'm going to give you the answer to this one. So it's going to be in Genesis 14, verses 18 through 20. Because I really want y'all, if you really want to get deeper into this Bible study, I want you to write this down. So where in the Old Testament is the question, can we read about Melchizedek? So Genesis 14, 18 through 20. Genesis 14, 18 through 20. And Psalm 110 and 4. Psalm 110 and 4. All right? Got that? All right. Number 3. So what does Melchizedek and the Son of God appear to have in common? What do they have in common? You can look at verse 3. What do they have in common? Melchizedek and the Son of God, what do they appear to have in common? Both appear to be without father and mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, remaining as priests continually. So we know that Mary birthed Jesus, but the genealogy comes through the father. And we know, right, that honestly, the father of Jesus Christ is not Joseph. All right. So that's where we get that from. All right. Jesus dies a death, but then 3 days later gets back up. So that lets us know what? There's no beginning of days. There's no beginning of days because he lives eternally. All right. All right, got that? All right, number four. Why is Melchizedek greater than both Abraham and Levi? Because at the end of the day, Hebrews points out that through Abraham, Levi literally is blessing Melchizedek, which implies that he is greater. Because the greater turns around and blesses the lesser. So then the lesser is blessed by the greater. See that? So he blesses, he gets blessed. See how that, remember what we talked about in scripture? The blessing, all right? That makes sense? The Bible talks about the lesser is blessed by the greater. So we know that because of this act, Melchizedek is literally greater than Abraham and Levi, all right? Number five, why was there a need for a change in priesthood? Simply put, because it made nothing what? The old priesthood made nothing what? What's the word? The change needed to come in the order of the priesthood, because that priesthood made nothing what? Verse 11. Made nothing what? Made nothing perfect. Right? Could not make anything perfect. And what was required for there to be a change in the priesthood? And this is something I was studying earlier, and I don't have a lot of time to deal with my answer. But the question is, why or what was required for there to be a change in the priesthood? According to verse 12 and 18, the law had to be changed or nullified. Okay? Or nullified. Why? Because under the old law couldn't make you perfect. That's why Jesus had to come. So this whole idea of thinking that a religious mind can change you, it can't. The only thing that can change a person is the power of God himself through the person of Jesus Christ. Once you receive Jesus Christ, you receive perfection in him. And then the Holy Spirit perfects out what God put in. The Holy Spirit works out what God works in. He puts perfection in you and then works perfection out of you. And perfection is not perfection like we think. Like, oh, you'll never sin, you'll never mess up. You'll just, no, it means complete. Amen. Verse 7. What evidence is there that the law has been changed? The law had to be changed. Number one, remember what I told you at the beginning. Abraham's descendants, which would be Isaac, then Jacob. Jacob has the 12 tribes. Levi, all the priests come out of the tribe of Levi, which is the Levitical order. Obviously, the priest, Jesus Christ, came from the tribe of Judah. So that lets you know that the law had to be changed. Because now, the priest no longer came from Levi, but he came from the order of Melchizedek. You see that? Okay? All right? Now, as I close, list some of the qualifiers. Those qualities of Jesus' priesthood. What are some of those? Huh? He's able to save to the utmost. He's been perfected forever. He offered up himself once and for all. Holy, harmless, undefiled. separated from sin, always lives to make intercession, an unchangeable priesthood, hallelujah, and the surety of a better covenant. And those are just some of those as it pertains to Jesus Christ and his priesthood. All right, so that'll be the end of our Bible study tonight. Listen, I certainly pray that somebody got something out of this Bible study. It was literally amazing. It was a blessing. God gave us some really good nuggets. He literally gave us meat to chew on tonight. Those that may find it hard to digest, it was very meaty. This Bible study is going to become even more meaty as we, go on to chapters 8, 9, 10. Let's see, I think it's, 13 chapters. And as you can see, 7 wasn't that long, but it took us, an hour to get through it just by taking our time and hearing what the Holy Spirit was trying to show us in chapter 7. And so we thank and praise God for that. Amen. So I pray that you guys got something out of this. I pray that your understanding of the book of Hebrews is widening and getting deeper so that you truly understand the person of Jesus Christ, the priesthood of Jesus Christ, and who you are because of who he has become forever. He is forever our priest. He is your priest. He is the high priest. Amen. So as I've been studying and really seeking God's face on it, I really pray that you guys were blessed by this Bible study tonight. I am over my time, and so I've really got to get out of here. But I love each and every one of you so very much. May God continue to bless you and keep you and raise you in his word. And may you understand that God is crazy about you. And he literally died for you. He loves you so much. He died for you so that you may live. I love you again. May God bless you and God keep you. If you're just clicking on and you want to get understanding of the book of Hebrews, we're in chapter 7, you can watch the replay. I love you so much. God bless each and every one of you.